Hi, I'm Michael Palazzola with the LSU Ag Center, and today I'd like to visit with you about grafting pecan trees. First, let's look into a little bit of why you would want to graft a pecan tree. And part of it is they do not come true to seed, and this is a representative of one that might come up from seed. It could be all types of sizes. It can be bigger or smaller than this. And for a commercial orchard, that's just not viable. We would rather have a select few number of varieties, and to do that, you're going to need to propagate them asexually. There's several ways to do that, through cutting or grafting, and even tissue culture. But for pecans, the most viable way is for us to do it through grafting, because they don't root well, and they don't really tissue culture too terribly well either. And today what we're going to be grafting is Elliott pecans, because that's the dominant cultivar in the Louisiana pecan industry. Now let's go over some of the tools you're going to need to get started grafting. First, most importantly, is your signwood. As I mentioned, it's asexual propagation. So we have to collect this Elliott signwood from an Elliott tree. And it needs to be one that's rapidly growing. Normally they're pruned that way so that they constantly put out nice good vegetative growth like this. And we collected the signwood in January when the tree was still dormant, and we sealed it with wax to prevent necrotic or dead cells from going too far. If you don't seal it, you would actually get dead cells up to this far, but since we have it sealed, we only have it about up here. You're also going to need some good bypass pruners. Ones that have an anvil like this make it much easier to cut. So this is my bypass pruners I use to do the initial cut, and then I keep a separate sharper pair for cutting another part of the process. You're going to need some paraffin tape, and I prefer this laboratory film, but both of these work just as well. You're going to want some way to mark it, especially if you're grafting with other people, so you can see who ends up with the best success rate later on. I prefer to use these type of rubber bands to tie it up tight after, and these are part of the four-flap grafting process as well. And I like to have a cup of water to stick my sign in after a cut so that I don't have to go quite as quick. Thankfully, once you've practiced enough, you'll go quick enough that you shouldn't need it too bad, but I find it's a good way just to ensure that you have that extra little bit of time for your pecan grafts. Labels and a pin if you're grafting multiple varieties. It's no good if you graft and you can't tell what you grafted later. So we're going to label some of these, even though I'm grafting all Elliott here at this nursery. Most importantly, a good heavy-duty grafting knife. This is a Tina knife made in Germany, made specifically for grafting. Has very good high-quality steel. I like to sharpen mine about once a day, but it can last even longer than that. I can get about 100 grafts out of this, no problem at all, and probably even more. But I just like to have a nice sharp knife because you want to make good smooth cuts. A jagged cut does not heal as well as a smooth cut, so having a nice, good, heavy-duty, sharp grafting knife is important. And the quality of it as well, a more expensive one will likely hold its edge much longer. And an important part of any grafting kit, band-aids or some other way, unfortunately, you do it long enough, you're going to cut yourself. Now, the good thing about band-aids, and I do this process when I'm doing like 300 grafts in a few short days, you might want to preemptively wrap some areas where you're rubbing yourself raw, so it is useful just for preemptively protecting yourself as well. Now let's go ahead and jump into doing our number one tree. We're going to do several trees, and next one will be close up so you can see how to do it. But first thing you want to do is cut off the top here. So this is our root stock. The main reason we're growing this is to give us a root system so that we have the Elliott to grow to. And I'm going to cut this guy about right there. And another important aspect we're going to do is we're going to preemptively wrap a rubber band there. And the grafting method we're doing today is called banana or four flap. I do a modification of that called the three-flap grafting method just because I find it works easier for smaller wood. The larger you get, four-flap becomes probably the best way, but for about a medium to small size, I find three-flap works best for me. Now, we're going to try to find a piece of sign wood that matches up fairly close. And I like this guy, even though it's a little bit crooked. Now, if this was not sealed quite as well, you would want to cut it off right here because it would be dead up to that point. I've grafted a lot with this particular sign wood this year. I know I don't have to worry about that because we processed it so high quality. So I'm going to want to do about 3 evenly spaced cuts here, like that. Do it in one smooth cut if you can. About right there, and about right there. Now we need to leave these little strips here. What we're doing is the cambium, this little green in between that, is the only part that's alive and viable that we want to connect with cambium on here. Now, like I said, I'm going to go ahead and put it in the water real quick so I can take a little bit longer and start to be explaining some of these processes to you. Now, we put it in that water so it doesn't dry out. If it dries out, it kills the cambium cells. It's no longer viable. So we want to do this process all as quickly as possible. And I was going through talking about that, but I pressed the blade in 3 times around here so I could make my 3 flaps. And I'm going to go ahead and pull them down. And that's the other thing. We can only do this at certain times of year when the plant's actively growing. You try this the wrong time of year, it is not going to pull like this smooth. Also, don't touch this as much as possible. When you touch, you dry it out and it reduces the viability. And now part of the anvil is it has a bit of a crushing cut. So I'm going to want to come back and cut a little bit of that off where I damaged it from that initial cut there. Because it's dead cells don't heal. So we want to remove where dead cells might be. Coming through, removing this left there. And this is why we had to roll the rubber band on there beforehand, so that we could roll it up smoothly like this. Now, I messed up a little bit there and I've adjusted it. Ideally, don't wiggle it like that. But if you have to, it's better to do that so that you have the cambium, which is this on this side, connected with the cambium right there. The next thing we're going to do is we're going to wrap it under a little bit of tension. Having the tension kind of forcing these together aids the healing process, means that they're closer together. That little tension helps them fuse together at the cellular level better. Don't want to do it so tight that you make the sign kind of bend, because then that's an issue tree training later. But we have it all together like this. Our next step's going to be getting some paraffin to wrap it up so that it does not dry out. Looks like this tree is trying to join us here. Oh. So it takes a minute sometimes to get the paraffin off, but we're getting it there. It's only not wanting to work because I'm on camera. So we're going to want to stretch this. What we're doing is this is trapping moisture. Like I said, if that cambium layer dries out, it is no longer viable. Now we are stretching it just thin enough where these buds at the top here, that's the other thing. Make sure what you're grafting has some viable buds on top of there. We're wrapping it just thin enough here so that the buds can poke out and start growing as it heals. I like to do a little bit extra layer around here where it's a little bit most sensitive. And like I said, at this nursery, my color is purple. So I am marking this tree as purple. So hopefully that we can find that I have the best success rate. And then we will have labeled the tree and put that in here. Now, all of these out here are Elliott, so it's not truly needed. But when we start grafting a handful of the pollinators for Elliott, it's going to be critical that we label it so that we can keep track of those trees. So here we are grafting another one more close up. I've already done the top cut and put the rubber band on, but I want you to see here where the anvil pruners damage a little bit. And that's just inevitable, and that's why I was cutting off the little tops a little bit. And we'll do the same on this, and you can see it hopefully a little bit better. Now let's look for a piece of sign wood. This one's a good fit, but it's a bit crooked, so we're going to look for another one. This one's nice and straight and good, and we have good viable buds here. That's the other thing. We want to check and make certain we have really good buds for it. Pecans have a nice heart-shaped leaf scar, So we know that if it's heart-shaped, it's pointed the right direction. The buds should be up. Now, we're going to go ahead and cut, like I said before, I'm not going to cut this off. If it wasn't sealed so well, I would cut about right here to start with because the cells would probably be dead to that point. But I'll show you real quick. You see, there is no necrotic layer except right here. So it's no use for me going ahead and doing that secondary cut because this one was sealed and stored so well. Also, we can see I did that one smooth cut across. You want to do just one sharp cut so that you're not damaging the cells as much for this process. I want to go ahead and cut the other evenly balanced like that. You could do it bigger, but I prefer just for my method to just do one swift cut. I'm going to go put that in the water real quick. And now I'm going to show you how I get my flaps started. I press into it like that. And part of it is because I'm doing three flap. If I was doing four flap, I could do like this. But there's no way to evenly distribute three flaps in that way. And I prefer three flaps because I can get the connection with the cambium much better that way. Now, sometimes it can be a little bit of a trick to peel back. But once you get it, you try to ensure like that. Now, generally the window of time that we can do that is about April to June in Louisiana. Preferably do it as quick and early in the season as you can, because the hotter it gets, the harder that healing process is going to be. And this is my sharper anvil pruners that I'm using just to do this little cut to remove the little damage that was done by my larger bypass pruners. I'm bringing my bypass pruners back to go ahead and do this. I like to have two separate pruners for that so I don't dull the other one. And now we're going to line up. See how smoothly that fits together. I like to have one about the same size. There's other people who prefer to have it bigger and have pressure there, but this is my ideal way to get it connected here. Nice good coverage, and in some cases when we pull this tension, it will actually connect the flaps back together, which will speed the healing process there. Now, this is sometimes the hardest part for most people, is learning how to do this band. Inevitably, it's going to fly off every now and then. That's okay. Just redo it. Get it tied on there tight. That tension is going to aid on our healing process by holding it tightly up against here. Again, we don't want it so tight that it would cause it to slant any particular direction, because then you have a slanted tree that you have to pull up. Now, we want to go ahead and maintain the moisture as much, so we're going to get some paraffin tape. Our film, and we're going to go ahead and get it started on here. I find sometimes it helps to give it a preemptive little rip like that. Gives you a spot to get your fingers there so that you can get the paper off of it. Go ahead and get this little last remnant off, because we don't want that stuck in between. And we're going to pull it up. That happens too. It happens a lot. And you just roll with it and you keep going, because you want it to be stretched thin, especially over the top here, because we don't want it to be so thick that our buds struggle to push through. I like to cover the very top of it too, where it's exposed a bit. And then I like to have a little bit extra and do just one more turn around here to ensure that I keep that moisture trapped. And again, at this nursery, my color is purple. My color everywhere just about is purple. And I'm going to go ahead and mark my tree at the bottom here so that we can keep track and see what my success rate is at the end of the season. You should start to see some signs of life in your graft fairly quickly. This one, it's a nice big piece of sine wood. I don't want to move it too much because it's still forming the connections here in the vascular system. But we see here that the bud is starting to swell. So this is a sign of life, and hopefully this means that this will be a successful graft. There are some cases though where a sign can outgrow the bottom, but with here just this one bud, this is a good sign that the sign's in good shape, and hopefully that our connections here in between the rootstock and the sign are being successful. Next, we're going to look at a more established graft. Now this is hopefully what all of our hard work will turn into. This is a successful four flap graft from last year. We can even still see the remnants of the flap if we look closer. And this is what the sign was, and this was the rootstock. So this should eventually grow to a point where you won't even recognize where it was grafted in most times. And this is what a finished graft should look like a year from now. And this tree here is ready for you to plant out in the field. This has been Michael Palazzola with the LSU Ag Center showing you how to graft pecan trees.